And it's another for me is that what they call an enthusiastic amateur, chopping or throw these professionals. As such, that's why I got to use this lecture and have my notes in case I forget what I was going to say. The Fortingall Kirkyard survey is part of the Fortingall project, which was formed from the Godolphin Heritage Society, James M. Clown Society, and Fortingall and Glen Lyon Cook Session, coordinated by the Godolphin Development Association. Now, here in Tappa, you probably know all about Fortingall, if only because of the ancient yew tree, here drawn by Pennant in the 18th century, to just have a haircut. Or maybe you admire the picturesque thatched cottages designed by James McClellan. And of course, there's always people like Campbell of Glen Lyon, notorious for Glencoe, and also the Dean of Lismore, pre-Reformation vicar of Fortingall, who collected Gaelic songs. And you know that the Vale of Fortingall is full of archaeological interest. Standing stones, clifftop fort and homestead, another medieval moated homestead marked in the old maps as the praetorium of an imaginary Roman camp, nothing to do with Pontius Pilate, of course. The nearby Neolithic burial mound, hut circles, cut marked stones, Bronze Age cairns and cemetery, etc. And now aerial photographs held by, at least used to be held by the Royal Commission, show crop marks in the fields around the church that seem to mark a vallum, the boundary of an early monastery, the source presumably of the early Irish monk spell, kept in the kirk with the Pictish cross fragments. In 1997, we read the analysis of the early Christian stones in the Kirk and Kirkyard by Neil Robertson in The Worm, the Germ and the Thorn. And for the millennium, a new display of the stones was arranged in the church and fine drawings made by Ian Scott. And a Kirk and Village exhibition for the centenary of the rebuilt Kirk also resulted in the guidebook produced with the help of Perth and Kinross Heritage Trust. Then in 2003, Alan Calder published his monograph on the work of James McClellan, establishing the village's importance in the arts and crafts movement and Scottish architecture. And that gave rise to our James M. McClellan Society. In 2007, as you see from last year's TAPEC journal, there was an archaeological investigation of part of the scheduled site of the putative Celtic monastery. And then in 2010, Oliver O'Grady asked for local volunteers to help with the geophysical survey of the site. The results of this indicated not only a significant vallum, but a complex of buildings within it. In 2011, Dr. O'Grady returned with his team, augmented by more volunteers, to excavate what seemed to be two significant sections of the vallum. This is us opening the trench on the west side in the church glebe, and this the dig on the north side, which was eventually interpreted as an entrance. Meanwhile, the glebe dig soon revealed a revetment of the vallum with the embankment and a ditch outside which went down and down and down, finally resulting at the bottom in a depth of over 1.5 meters. As the earth from the ditch was presumably piled up to form the embankment, you could imagine someone approaching this fortification would encounter a barrier of over 3 meters, plus presumably a fence on the top. So the stronghold church, as the name Fortingall seems to mean, must have been a major settlement. Think how many men and man-hours must have gone into building that vallum. According to O'Grady, carbon dating puts it to the late 7th century, just the time of St. Abdamnon, who local tradition has was the missionary in our area. And it maybe was rebuilt or strengthened later at the time of the Norse incursions. Also, a later investigation by Oliver pointed to perhaps an even earlier Christian activity on the site. So, us interested local people created the Fortingall Roots project to try and find out more about this organise and raise funds for more investigations. But we struggled, this was getting more and more difficult, and it was Bertrand Pupkin Ross Heritage Trust wisely suggested that we should start a more limited objective. Now, the Fortingall Kirk Session wanted to find a way of sheltering some of the old stones, particularly the strange stones with triple crosses on them, which are a picture of Fortingall, which was scattered around the kirkyard. And we were advised that first we should do an accurate survey of the kirkyard to find out if there were more old stones beneath the turf. For this, we should use the techniques worked out by the Murray Graveyards Research Group. We invited members of the Murray group to come down and advise us. Here's one of them demonstrating perhaps the most important of the special tools required, the plastic tip probe used to establish if there was a stone no more than 4 inches below the surface. You don't want to go any deeper when you're on a graveyard. First, we had to clear the masses of ivy in the kirkyard dikes. One of the things this mammoth task revealed was this stray stone lying on top of the dike with a crude DR marked among the scars of the ivy. We were also intrigued by this more modern monument that the rampant ivy had obscured to Alexander Patterson Somerville from Glasgow, donor of the Mungo Prize for a leading citizen of that city. The inscription tells us that he wished his ashes to be buried beside the grave of his lifelong friend, who had died in Fortingall during the war. We were able to contact a representative of the family who came up to tell us more about his uncle, a good example of how the families of those commemorated would be interested in the project. We're lucky to have Claire Thomas as one of our Fortingall Group's team. She makes sure that everything is done in the correct way. In the summer of 2013, we began our survey, laying out a grid and marking accurately the position of all the stones, which were each given an individual number. We were then able to start recording each stone using the Council for Scottish Archaeology recording form, showing the composition and position of the stones with an exact copy of the inscription and, as far as possible, any decoration or symbols on the stone. This takes a lot of time, and after our main session was over, members of the team continued to come and record more of the stones over the autumn and the next spring. In April last year, we began our survey again, spending a week probing the turf to locate any buried stones. We started at the east end of the kirkyard. Here are Claire and Gordon Stark, the Kirk's session clerk, preparing to lift the turf, which revealed these slabs. They're quite blank, but good quality and finely dressed. Here they are cleaned, and in Claire's careful sketch. Since the adjoining headstone is a Duncan Robertson, we can surmise that these slabs lie over a Robertson lair, a supposition confirmed when we managed to get hold of an old lair plan. Now, in the late 18th century, the Clan Donaghy chiefs lived underneath, just across River Rhine from the village, so it wouldn't be surprising to find quality slabs there. But why are there no markings on them? We found some other rough slabs nearby with the date 1726 and the initials DR roughly carved on them, probably other Duncan Robertsons, Duncan being a very popular name for members of the Clan Donaghy. But most slabs we found were completely blank. Was it not thought proper and Presbyterian then to identify yourself on the stone covering your grave? To the west of the Robertson ground, near to headstones for later 19th century McGregors, were more blank stones, but one with ING on it, a John McGregor, another DR beside it. Either these overlap the layers, or slabs have been lifted and then laid down somewhere else. With all these slabs often touching each other, and with other slabs left alongside the walls, it was becoming clear that headstones had only become common in Fortingall in the second half of the 19th century. Before then, the whole burial ground would have been covered by such slabs. Were they all on the surface, with no grass to be seen? Altogether, in that week, in April, we uncovered 10 horizontal slabs and 2 small vertical ones. Apart from a few initials and dates, there was only one which had any symbol or decoration. When this was uncovered, the cry went up, "An axe looks like a tomahawk." When we emailed the pictures around our contacts, we were immediately told, "No, don't be silly, that's a plow." You can see it clearer on Claire's drawing. Was this AR a farmer, a plowman, or maybe a wright who specialised in ploughs and poulterers? All these revealed stones were carefully recovered with the turf as exactly as we could. Sometimes it was a bit easier, the turf just peeled off. Then the position of these stones was carefully plotted. We resumed our work in August, preparing for visits by school groups and hoping that we would have some interesting stones for them to find. Here we are carefully probing at regular intervals along the strings that mark the lines on the grid, marking where we felt resistance and where there might be stones, cutting squares of the turf to see if there was a stone there, and again, it was actually tightly packed gravel that had misled us. As we were probing areas that had been more often used in the last 100 years, we concluded that what slabs there had been there had been lifted by the grave diggers and left aside. We were worried that there would be no inscriptions for the schools to find, as the stones we did uncover were all blank. But luckily, we struck gold, or at least initials and dates. The first of the groups from Pitlochry High School were excited to unearth the initials DC and GN 1752. The second group working on their stone explained, "We've beaten you, 1710. Bad weather was forecast for the Godolphin Academy visit on Thursday, so we sat up a shelter over the stones we were clearing, and again we seemed to find only rough, blank stones. They were remarkably enthusiastic despite the rain, and they were eventually rewarded with this one. We're not sure if the double N was a mistake or not, but it was still recorded exactly. Just to prove that we didn't disturb the graves too much, the autumn crocuses put on a lovely display over where we've been working. This year, we have finished recording the inscriptions on the headstones, and as in previous years, we led walks for Perth and Cynos Archaeology Month here at Dungale and here on the so-called Praetorium. Then in August, after the schools had gone back, we finished probing all the ground to the south of the Kirkyard Path with parties from the same local schools along to help with the survey. We have to be careful about health and safety, so we noted problem headstones in our risk assessment. This tabletop has shifted a bit, and for this leaning stone, Andy devised an ingenious prop before cleaning and recording the exposed stone. Didn't see it properly. One of those with a triple cross, and yet more D. McG. initials. One of the last interments in Greygard was our old friend Donald McGregor, and there were many before him. We didn't find any new stones under the turf this August, and nor did the pupils. However, neither this nor the weather dented their enthusiasm. They ran about filling out a quiz on the inscriptions and helped record the stones on the kirkyard wall. This is a typical small headstone. Well, this inscription looks rather more suitable for a marriage ritual. As a reward, the pupils were admitted to the Holy of Holies inside the U enclosure. By the way, here are a few of the earliest upright headstones, which may reveal interesting facets of life at this time. This stone is one of the few to have symbols of mortality on the back. This is the front, with a winged soul. And the inscription says, "Here lies the remains of the charitable Gristle Stewart, spouse to Alexander MacDougall Grazier." But why is she called the charitable Gristle? Note that she was married to a grazier, that is, one of the new men who replaced the black cattle with sheep. He was probably well enough off to afford to put up a stone for his wife, a fashion he may have imported from the lowlands along with the sheep. This one has initials in the old form, as well as the full name. This one is of another McNaughton, a mason, maybe the man who had been carving these stones, but if so, his successor can't manage to get his ends the right way around. If you can see this, the ends the wrong way. What next? We still have what may be the most interesting part of the kirkyard to test for stones under the turf. Then we have to put everything together for visitors to refer to, and we can add to this information we get from these visitors about their families. But we have to have all this in a digital form as well. More practically, we have to protect the historic stones, either in a shelter, somewhere in the yard. In the long term, we have all these other sites around Fortingall to investigate. Visitors ask us, when are you going to finish excavating the Celtic monastery you're talking about? Others suggest the hill forts. The more practical idea is to do a survey of the so-called Praetorium. As has recently been discovered, the ancient yew, apparently for thousands of years male, has started producing female berries. So anything could happen in Fortingall. Thank you.